We discovered when I was at NID that in one of the finest and most precision moments in making space vehicles in Bangalore at ISRO, the flame is finally tested by an Urali maker from Kerala, whose ability to test the heat of the flame by looking at the flame is more accurate than any instrument that ISRO had. So it's not as if hastkala and dastakars are important only for the craft activity, handmade products. They are important to all manufacture. This slogan, well, not with a question mark, a few years ago when we were struggling with the Planning Commission here, we heard from our colleagues in the European Union that the European Union had come out with a slogan saying, the future is handmade. So we contacted them and asked, this is wonderful, I wish that we had said that, but since you have said it in the European Union, what do you mean? Do you mean that Europe is going to pack up its machines and go back to the days of everything handmade? They said no. What we mean is that Europe has lost its craft culture. It has lost its artisans. It's lost its craftsmen and women. Unless we can bring that culture back to Europe, we cannot compete in the international market, because the crafts are the source of creativity and innovation in any society, and we have lost it. So the future has to be handmade in that sense, that the value of this culture that brings the hand, eye, and mind together must be revived in Europe for our economic survival, as well as for our cultural survival. Because we have lost our identity in this globalized world of McDonald's and Coca-Cola and blue jeans and t-shirts and baseball caps. If we want our own identity, we also have to remember our craft culture and our ability to express what is special about ourselves and what we value about ourselves. So we're back to education, and we're back to your field of teaching and of igniting young minds with the value of this. It's not that we have not had wonderful demonstrations of what the artisan can do and how the artisan can succeed. Kamala Devi set up the Central Cottage Industries. There have been other successful ventures in the private sector. Activists have done a great amount of work. You have organizations like, for example, Titan Watches, which is entirely artisan-based, artisan and designers working together. And now they've moved into the Tanishq range of jewelry. But that's a wonderful example. Some years ago, NID graduates working in Titan rang me up from Bangalore to say, we have a problem. The Swiss will not allow Titan watches to be exhibited at some global conference or some global watch thing in Geneva. So I said, why? They said, something about competition, we're not quite sure. So I said, you're worried about this? It's the best certificate you can receive. If the Swiss are worried about Titan watches, you've made it. But that was an example of what happens when artisans and engineers and marketing people come together. So that, as I said, it's not just a matter of the value of the handmade product. It's also the importance of that culture of creativity which crafts represents. This concept of cultural industries can be built up. I don't want to take time on this. If you are interested, you can read my paper and you'll find out more about it. But ultimately, it is about building demand for quality, the quality that comes from the hand and the eye and the mind working together. To build this demand, we have to start with education. And I think, when was it, in 2011, that Professor Krishna Kumar gave a lecture from this very podium on Hastkalayang or Shiksha. That is an extremely important paper, which I think should be absorbed by teachers not only at CCRT, but in every part of India. And I hope that his observations, which then led to the NCERT syllabus on craft education at the school level, a very important development. There is disappointment, I understand, and Professor Krishna Kumar is disappointed that more schools in this country have not taken it up. But some of us in the Crafts Council have contacted schools and they have said, well, we like it, but we don't have teachers who can conduct this course adequately. They don't come from a background where they understand the course content and can interpret it for children. So here again is a task for CCRT. How can that NCERT syllabus be taken to scale throughout the country? One first step which I would recommend is that Professor Krishna Kumar's paper, which is now Hastkalayan or Shiksha, which is now only available in Hindi, needs to be translated and shared, because so much is at stake, and it's a brilliant paper. The artisans themselves are our great educational resource. They are great, great teachers. We don't recognize them as teachers, but they are. They cannot be employed as teachers because they don't have formal qualifications. No Indian university, despite Dr. Kapila Vatsan's efforts, have received honorary degrees from our universities. She tried at Benaras Hindu University that the weavers of Benaras, the master weavers of Benaras, should be recognized by the university. Nay, didn't happen. At the National Institute of Design, artisans who taught students in our workshops were acknowledged as faculty members. When they joined the convocation procession some years ago, I, as director, received a letter from the Ministry of Education to say, what business have you to put unqualified people as part of your convocation procession? These were some of our greatest teachers. The manner in which they could communicate materials, the manipulation of materials, the handling of materials, the respect for quality, the respect for joinery, for detail, unequaled. And the Ministry of Education was telling us, why did you have them in the convocation procession? That is a revelation of the lack of respect in our country for the dastkar, for the artisan. Why did that happen? Now I am told that happened because of the caste system and other reasons. But that was the failure of the past generation with all that they did, and my generation, for all that we tried to do, that we didn't understand that at the heart of this whole thing was the lack of respect. The lack of respect for this great Indian resource. If they were respected, it would be impossible to have come through that ridiculous scheme of putting a motor onto a handloom. And that respect can only come from education, from awareness, from something that happens between the ears, in the brain, in the mind. And what are we going to do about that? However, we must also not forget that even though we in the sector often blame ourselves for what is happening, things have happened in the country at a scale which is beyond us. And let me just quickly tell you some of those things that have happened. One is, of course, that the market is transformed. 1951-2014. I don't need to go into the transformation of the market. You can see it all around you. How is the artisan to be empowered to negotiate with this new market? Not just in India, but overseas. What does the artisan need to be able to deal with competition from mass production, from imitations, from forgeries, from price competition? How? Where is the market research? Who is going to train them in entrepreneurship? The artisans that we in the Crafts Council of India and the Craft Revival Trust and the Crafts Museum, the artisans that we are dealing with, the young people, they don't want to leave the profession. But they want to know whether they can live a decent and dignified life. They want training in computer studies. They want entrepreneurial training. They want to know how, they want language training. They want to learn business skills. And we have schemes from the government of India which do not address these adequately. So that's one thing that we have to keep in mind, that this is no longer even a village industry. Many Indian crafts today are made in city slums because the rural artisan has no access to capital, to market, to the services that anyone needs in order to buy and sell. You will see them all over, I'm sure, even here in Dwarka, making jharus, making chicks, making all these things that the government of India does not recognize as Indian craft, but are Indian craft. But they have to come to their cities. And yet, we continue to talk about cottage industries. They're not cottage anymore. They're made in crowded urban slums. There's another problem about this. Both Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay and Pupul Jaikar have written about it, how the inspiration of Indian craft has come from contact with nature. You take the artisan out of the rural setting, put him into a slum in Delhi or Bangalore or Calcutta or Madras or Ahmedabad. Where is that contact with nature? Where will the inspiration come from? Will they just copy what their ancestors did? Where is the inspiration to come from? Unless we find some way of giving them back the environment which they have lost. Kapilaji has written extensively on this issue of how this contact with the earth is absolutely central to India's craft culture. And that if you lose that contact with the earth, you have lost the context which has made the crafts what they are. The Taj Mahal is a wonderful example of it. It took place in an urban environment, but what is the inspiration of the Taj? It all comes from nature, every inch of it. Those artisans lived with nature, they celebrated nature, not just at the Taj, but everywhere, including Banaras brocade and all our other great crafts. So, if they have to shift away from a rural environment and some contact with nature, what will happen to that creativity that we want to protect? And even if they stay in their villages, what are we doing to our environment? There are many artisans are dependent on natural materials. But what have we done about those natural materials? They're disappearing. Great crafts like sandalwood, for example, finished. There's no sandalwood. Ivory trading is banned. Woods are disappearing. Grasses are rare. Cane and bamboo in the northeast is also threatened. The potter who depends in our towns and cities on clay and water, they're pushed away. In Ahmedabad, we had a community of potters not far from the gates of NID. When I first came there in 1975 and I was taken to Lothal, I came back and I was astonished to find that here at the gate, almost at the gates of the National Institute of Design, the same forms and the same decoration on the forms that I had seen at the museum at Lothal. 6,000 years of history, intact, at the doorstep of the National Institute of Design. Those potters have been removed from there in a beautification project. And their space has been put in as a non-functioning fountain. This is what we do to our artisans. But when there is a festival of India or if there's a mela, the potter is dragged out and we recite from the Vedas about how our whole culture, our whole civilization is symbolized in the pot. But who cares about him? Which ministry is concerned with the potter? Not the Development Commissioner of Handicrafts. The development of Commissioner of Handicrafts is involved with art pottery. So if you make a pot which looks like Mickey Mouse, Development Commissioner of Handicrafts is there. If you make the classic mud pot or the diya, unfortunately no. That's not our concern. So there are all these issues. I'll give you another. Most Indian artisans are from communities who are at the margins of Indian society. Scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, the poor, and women. Take a map of India in your classrooms. Trace the Naxal corridor. Trace the places of greatest unrest in our country. Kashmir, northeast. That Naxal corridor, which goes down through Madhya Pradesh from UP, and those two areas are our greatest craft resources. Does that tell you something about the neglect for the crafts? So crafts are also a social safety net for millions of those who are at the margins of Indian society, giving them jobs where they are located, in their own location, putting a brake of some kind on migration into cities, the miseries that go with it. If we can in fact make the village a place where services are made available to them, livelihoods where they are located. Just the issue of the Naxal corridor and these areas of our country like Kashmir in the northeast that I mentioned also point out that crafts cannot take place in an unjust society. Crafts cannot take place, creativity cannot happen if you feel that nobody cares for you and if you are angry. You cannot create great crafts, obviously. So there is also an aspect of peace and justice which is essential in terms of the future of Indian crafts. So here is a industry that addresses issues of livelihood, addresses issues of human rights, of peace, of justice, which addresses issues of the environment and of climate change. This colossal industry of India in India has the lowest carbon footprint of any industry. And you still don't respect it when the whole world is talking about climate change. And has cultural and spiritual values about which CCRT knows a great deal. I don't need to go into them. It's not just about economics. It's not just about sales and statistics. It's about what makes us who we are and what we value about who we are. I have just come back from a two-day discussion at the Ramakrishna Mission in Calcutta, where the last volume in the cultural history of India, edited by Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan, was released day before yesterday at the Ramakrishna Mission. I was told that these volumes, the work on them, began in 1934, the year before I was born. 80 years of work have gone into creating the cultural history of India. And the Swamijis were saying that these 80 years of work are about values. And that if we are losing values, then what is the meaning of these 8 volumes and 80 years of work for future generations in India? This was debated at a seminar over the last 2 days. We don't have answers for that. But there is a great opportunity which is in front of us in the year 2015. I told you that no other industry represents the kind of contribution to the most basic development issues that the globe is facing than the craft sector. No other industry can match it for being able to address these issues. In 2015, the members of the United Nations, including India, will be engaged in something that is called developing the Sustainable Development Goals, which are going to direct and drive international development over the next 15 years, up till 2030. Here is our chance to make a case not only for the crafts of India, but for the crafts of the world. That we have an industry, we in India have an industry, that can address the needs of the future in a way that no other industry can. That this is an opportunity that we have to bring its contribution together, not only in India, but around the world, to show that there is hope for this planet. And one of the hopes for this planet is the fact that there is this global awareness about the importance of craft. We need to harness that global awareness. We need somehow to bring that global awareness into the heads of our own people, not just in government, but also in the private sector, also in schools and colleges, to value and to treasure our artisans so that the future can indeed be handmade. Handmade in India and handmade for the world. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the thought-provoking talk. May I now request Mrs. Ritu Sethi, guest of honor, to address the August gathering.
It is a great honor to share the dais with somebody I consider a mentor. And through his talk, he has demonstrated some of the reasons why. The clarity of his thinking, the philosophy behind his actions, his knowledge leadership, and above all, his belief that we can bring about change, and his ability to inspire us all to believe it too. Thank you. And I take this opportunity, Professor Chatterjee, not only on my behalf, but all the many you have inspired, to say thank you, thank you, thank you, for being teacher, guide, and mentor. I saw many people in the audience taking notes, and I want to say that we are fortunate that CCRT has brought out what he has said in this booklet. So don't go without it, because this is something, what he has said, I think, we have to read and reread and reread, because he said it so easily, but there's so much depth and knowledge and thinking behind it that for ordinary mortals like us, we will have to read it many times to get to the bottom of it. So thank you again.
Thank you, ma'am, for those enriching words. May I now request Dr. Chetan Singh, Deputy Director, CCRT, to kindly propose a word of thanks.
I feel honored to propose the vote of thanks and would like to express my deep gratitude to Professor Ashok Chatterjee Saab, who in spite of his very busy schedule and pressing commitments was so kind enough to agree to deliver 5th Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay Memorial Lecture. We all heard his vision while voicing dichotomize of Indian crafts experience, which has touched us all. His great vision revolving around crafts and touching upon development agenda inspire all of us. His address today, as always when he speaks of crafts or cultural traditions, has given new inspiration to all working in the field of cultural promotion, dissemination, and education. I would also express my deep gratitude to Honorable Chairperson CCRT, Srimati Reena Nanjanji, former Secretary, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and a scholar like Mrs. Ritu Sethiji, Dr. Premlata Puri, Dr. Shobita Punja, and Dr. Ruchira Ghosh and others, who have inspired us with their august presence today I would also like to take this opportunity to thank all officials of Ministry of Culture and other institutions who have unfailingly shared their expertise and provided cooperation and guidance to the center. I would also like to thank Ms. Rita Bokel and her colleagues for rendering soul-touching invocation on this auspicious opening. Last but not the least, I would also like to thank to all the distinguished members of the audience who are present here today. Thank you very much.